So we have been looking forward to this, and we had a great day today talking to a great couple of guys. We talked to Jake Crain and David Cohn of Crain and Company. There's actually three of them, Blaine Crain as well, but he was out today. But so we talked to Jake Crain and David Cohn, and these are guys who host the Crain and Company podcast for the Daily Wire. They're also three of the stars of Lady Ballers, which is I'll just use the Daily Wire's description of it. The most triggering comedy of the year, mocking men and women's sports. That's pretty much all you need to know. Everybody, these two guys who we talked to are in the movie. Everybody in the Daily Wire is in it.
Daily Wire sports podcast.
Yes, noticed like the comm staff and production staff like make cameos in this. So it's all in, which I love because it's kind of a comedy troupe. Now, the whole Daily Wire, they're all into this.
Mm-hmm. I love it.
Yeah, and we've talked to them. We had a great time talking to them just about this movie that dares to go someplace that movies generally don't dare to go. So we're going to jump right in with Jake Crain and David Cohn to talk about Lady Ballers. These guys are Crain and Company. Jake Crain and David Cohn. Okay, I am thrilled to bring in Jake Crain and David Cohn. They are one of three members of Crain and Company, along with Blaine Crain. In Crain and Company, you'll find on the Daily Wire, it's the sports show over there, which is something that is so refreshing for me to see, guys. And first of all, thanks for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having us, man. We're excited to come on and talk about it.
Yeah. These guys are all in Lady Ballers, which you should see. Just sign up for Daily Wire Premium and watch Lady Ballers. It is
the Daily Wire subscription makes a great gift, by the way. If like me, you have waited until the last minute and you have people that you need to shop for and you can't wait for stuff to ship, so it's perfect.
It is.
So this movie, so like last year, Matt Walsh dared to question the trans ideology stuff going on and men entering women's spaces, as the left likes to say. This year, these guys, Jake and Blaine and David, and the whole cast of Daily Wire are laughing at the other side, which is so entertaining and so good to watch. Do you ever look at this and say, wow, we actually gave this radical trend the middle finger? There may be fallout. Do you worry at all? Or are you gung-ho?
Oh, well, look, I mean, if we're worried about fallout, about talking about men playing in women's sports, then we've jumped the shark so far that it doesn't matter. I mean, to me, you know, obviously we cover sports at Crain and Company. It's very near and dear to our hearts. It's something that we believe is very important. We believe it's a great unifier. But in this sense, it's common sense. Men playing against women makes no sense. We can argue about immigration. We can argue about taxes. We can argue about foreign policy. The fact that we are arguing about should men and women be allowed to play sports together, to me, Cone, is one of the three reasons the aliens won't talk to us.
That is one of the top three reasons. But anybody who would come after us for saying that, you know, men and women's sports is one area of our society that should be bifurcated, then we don't take their opinion that seriously anyway. And back to your main point there, I don't look at the primary objective that we did was to give the middle finger to these people. I thought the main objective was to make a funny movie, right? Like, if you're going to make a comedy, it has to be funny first. Now, this film, I think, actually goes a step further. And it's a good movie, and it has heart in it, but it's funny first, which has to be the first step in a comedy, right?
Without a doubt. I mean, and listen, when you work for the Daily Wire, there's people that have kind of preconceived notions that they either like you or they don't like you. And, you know, we had some critics that wouldn't review it. We had some that did review it, and it got really good reviews. And then we had some, a couple that I saw that said it was racist, transphobic,
anti-Semitic. I asked Ben Shapiro, how dare you executive produce an anti-Semitic
movie? I know. It's wild. But if you watch the movie, I think one of the reasons it's been so successful and you know, we've gotten, for the majority, for mostly, you know, positive reviews off of it, is because there's a really good message in there, too. You know, it's one thing, like David said, for the slapstick comedy to be funny, for the humor to be funny, to be able to mock something in society that we believe should be mocked. And, you know, I come from an era, and he does too, of old school and Wedding Crashers and Dodgeball, where we used to be able to make fun of things in society before people got so scared they were going to get canceled that they ended up being paralyzed. So I think the overall heart and messaging of the movie isn't filled with hatred or spite. It's filled with nuance and reality. Yeah. And I think that's why people have gravitated to it.
Yeah, the family aspect actually is kind of touching towards the end, mostly as well, which is another lesson. I don't want to give it away. But you're right. And I'm older than you guys. In the 80s and 90s, you know, the joke was that all the bros, the college guys, we were all trying to find a way to sneak into women's locker rooms. Mm-hmm. You know, we wanted to see the ladies getting undressed for the pool. That was the hijinks, you know.
Now, well, even going back to Sandlot, I mean, Squint's fake drowning so he can kiss Wendy Peppercorn. I mean, now I don't even know if you could do that.
No, I don't think he could.
It almost felt weirdly like a throwback watching this movie, and we watched it with our son that we've obviously very
classic comedy, because there's nothing out now.
Comedy movies are dead. Aside from like some of the comedy specials that you can find, there's really not that much funny coming out. And this truly was a funny movie, which was so great and exciting to have something to watch. It's not just not like hit you over the head with a political point, but there's just a funny movie there.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, again, I think the national response to this movie has shown you there was clearly a demand without any supply. And Jeremy Boring and Ben Shapiro had a conversation and said, what if we make a movie that only the Daily Wire can make? And what if we cast the people who are coming in here every day to work hard for the Daily Wire and to fight on the cultural lines? And that's what we did. And so the international response has been incredible.
Yeah, and Cone, I think that you should get Best Supporting Actor for the Badger scene.
Sir. Thank you.
But, oh my goodness, Matt.
I'm having
Walsh.
PTSD right now.
Yeah.
Matt Walsh, the unassuming, dry humor Matt Walsh, was fantastic in this movie.
Yeah,
incredible.
Who knew? And now, is this your first movie too? First time being in a movie like this and on set and everything?
Yeah, well, you know, I tell people this is the first, you know, official movie that I've ever been in. I didn't, you know, go to any acting classes or anything like that. But we do a live sports show every day. You know, it's kind of like trying to get yourself in to be good at running sprints by running marathons. I feel like we do the hardest part before we can actually, you know, do something that's scripted. And they can say, wait, let's start over. Let's stop. Let's do this. In our show, we can't do that. So, yeah, it was our first. You know, my first technical acting experience. I'll let David talk about his background. But I think sports, and we say this all the time on the show, it's one of the greatest teachers of life because if you're facing something you haven't done before, I still wanted to compete. I wanted to be the best because of the guys that were around me. You get used to playing with the team. You understand how to work together, and it's important to you. And I think what we had and what made this movie so cool, and it almost fits, right? In a movie that you could not make in Hollywood, you should not make with Hollywood actors, right? It almost kind of fits together if you really think about it. So we took that as a challenge, and everything we do at the Daily Wire, and again, credit to Jeremy Boring and Ben Shapiro and Caleb Robinson and John Lewis and all the leaders here, you know, we want to be the best at it. We want to put our best foot forward and give people content that they can enjoy, that can make them think, and can bring them back, like you mentioned earlier, Alice.
And as far as my background, I directed and produced for 10 years before I met Jake Crain, and I acted in some of the things that I directed and produced, but mostly that meant if I was acting in something, I couldn't get someone else to do it, right? I had these projects that I had to direct and produce. Well, all of that's come full circle to now acting in a movie called Lady Ballers, and Jeremy Boring said, hey, here's a script. Do you want to dress up like a woman and play basketball? So my decade of film experience culminated in me dunking on girls, and I'm thrilled to say that it was a fantastic experience.
Yeah, and you're better for it.
So, you know, in the lead up to talking to you guys, I started watching a whole bunch of Crain and Company and listening as well. My pleasure. And I haven't been listening to sports talk. I know it's more than sports. It's sports culture, whatever. But sports talk, I haven't listened to it for about 5 years. And the reason why is that we're here in Boston. We live in Boston. I work in Connecticut. Our big sports station was WEEI in Boston. The big morning show was the Kirk and Callahan show. And it was a great sports show. And, you know, it got a little political here and there. One of the political things they said, and this is like 5 years ago, was that people shouldn't be sending their kids, their children, to trans camps to learn to go on the gender journey.
Yeah, it was in particular about a trans kid who was like 5.
Right.
Yeah.
And they said that was wrong. And that show, because they said that, the mob came for them and they deleted that show. And essentially has ended sports talk radio in Boston, which is a town that we used to win championships, you know, at least even 5 years ago.
The flagship Red Sox station now has ratings like.
Yeah. So it destroyed talk radio here in sports talk. So to see Crain and Company, you guys are out there. You've got protection. You're saying stuff that you can say, which is absolutely fantastic, which we absolutely need. And I just thoroughly enjoy it. And I hope that you, do you feel totally safe in saying anything you want?
Well, yeah, number one, thanks for listening. We appreciate it. You know, listen, and I'm sure you've heard this on the show. The Daily Wire lets us, you know, say what we feel. I think it's one of the best parts about working here is that we feel confident we can come in. And obviously, you know, there's some things you don't say in general that are way out of bounds, in my opinion. But they let us say what we really think. I think, too, and when you listen to the show, we don't get super political, right? You're not going to hear us do what ESPN does and just try and push all these agendas that really don't have anything to do with sports. If we're talking about men and women's sports, obviously we're going to talk about that. We're going to say what we think. If we're talking about Pride Night at the ballpark, I don't want Pride Night. I don't want hetero night. I don't want, you know, whatever your sexual orientation is or what happens in your bedroom, not at the ballpark. I want to go to the ballpark and watch the game. And it feels like, you know, it's funny. There's parallels in the movie, and David, I think you'll agree with me. Growing up, I used to watch SportsCenter over and over again, mm-hmm. all the time. Dan Patrick, Keith Olbermann, before he went to Shutter Island, wherever the heck happened to that dude. and it was just, you know, Linda Cohn, Stuart Scott, Kenny Mayne, all these guys, and it was about sports. Mm-hmm. But then it shifted. It shifted into using sports as a conduit to push political agendas. And we love sports. I've dedicated my life to sports. So has this man. It puts food on my table. It's very important to me because I think it's great for people, and we don't need to muddy those waters with the divisiveness that we have everywhere else in society. So we wanted to make a sports show that when people listen to it, they said, you know what? I don't know what Jake thinks about abortion.
Yep.
I don't know what Jake thinks about immigration, mm-hmm. but I know he thinks Dak Prescott's going to blow it in the playoffs. You know, that's at the end of the day. We wanted people that love sports, that moved away from it with the Colin Kaepernick stuff and all that, to be able to have a place to come back and say, you know what? I'll turn these guys on. They were all in it. I played and coached for 9 years mm-hmm. in college. He was a quarterback at Michigan. My brother was a D1AA wide receiver, and we grew up in it, man. So we love it and want to protect it, and that's why we started Crain Con.
To answer your very specific question there of do you guys come into work every day, you know, with the feeling that you can say whatever you want? Absolutely not. I mean, we're very fortunate to work at a place like the Daily Wire that encourages nuanced conversations, but we have to make the nuanced arguments. I mean, one of Jordan Peterson's greatest rules in that initial 12 rules for life is be precise in your speech. So we have to come on here and make sure that we are making logical arguments. And Jake hit the nail on the head with everything on the politics. I mean, when I first met him, one of the things he said was, I've started this sports show that's audio only. I'd like to be on video. I pretty much stay away from all politics and I just talk about ball. Now, a few things, you know, the world kind of changed over COVID where you saw football coaches getting fired who wouldn't take a vaccine. You saw players kneeling for the national anthem and this whole issue of men playing in women's sports. And we always wanted to kind of talk about these issues, but we didn't know if we should. And so we're at a place with at the Daily Wire here where we can come in and we want to talk about, is Dak Prescott going to blow it in the playoffs or not first? But if you have someone who's kneeling for the national anthem, or you have a man hoisting a trophy that's designated for women, best believe we're going to call that out. That's not political. That has nothing to do with the legislature or with Congress. I mean, we get more political when we talk about NIL discussion and we have Tommy Tuberville on saying, what is the PASS Act going to look like? No one calls us out for being political when we're talking about actual legislation. So I think right now we have a pretty good thing going and the audience has responded well.
Well, and like you say, sports is something that impacts everybody and so many people, you know something about. So it's really, these are more common sense issues, especially this women's sports issue than political issues per se. And it's funny watching it because the debate with women's sports a couple decades ago was about Title IX and, you know, that women's sports were taking away from men's sports almost under Title IX in college athletics in particular. And now it's so weird to me to see the same people who were saying, you know, this is feminism, we're championing women's sports, kind of almost switch sides and say, no, what Title IX actually means is that the men can play on the women's teams. And they like turn completely around. And there's almost this accusation towards people who don't want men playing in women's sports. Like, well, you never cared about women's sports before. There's this great scene in the movie where the team comes out and there's nobody left in the stands. They've all left. And they kind of say, well, it's women's sports. No one watches. And I know that's like the joke. But I mean, do you think women's sports are important and why?
Yeah, well, I never thought I'd say I'd miss the days of Megan Rapinoe complaining about her lack of money making, even though, you know, in aggregate, they don't bring in as much as the men. Yes, women's sports is important because sports is very important. You know, it's one of the greatest teachers of life. I think this movie, from a schematic standpoint, us being able to pull it off, not being professional actors, was because we could always rely on that sports background of when it got tough, you got tougher. I think it teaches you how to deal with people. I think it teaches you how to perform under pressure, how to be able to bounce back from not performing under pressure or facing adversity. And nowadays, you know, a lot of people don't have that. And if women weren't able to have that, and if we let men play in women's sports, it's going to become men's sports. You know, one of my favorite lines in the movie, and not to give too much away, is when we're dunking literally on the women's team that we're playing against, and somebody in the stand says, "This is amazing. It looks just like men's basketball." Because that's the truth. So people ask me at first, they're like, "Well, Jake, why don't we just start a trans division?" Well, if you did that, eventually it's going to be a man's sport anyway. The men are going to take it over. So there's really no way to win. But yeah, there's so many girls out there that are as competitive as I am, right? My wife's one of them. She's an Alabama fan and I'm an Auburn fan. During the week of the Iron Bowl, we can barely look at each other, and I married her and stay with her the rest of my life. But there needs to be an outlet. And sports is one of the best outlets and one of the best teachers, David. I mean, we always look back on it.
And I think the biggest takeaway for this movie is to talk about how important women's sports are, not to take away that, oh, the average man could beat a successful woman in any and every sport. Our friend Riley Gaines is a great example of this. Riley Gaines would beat Jake and myself in any race in any swimming pool ever. She's just a better swimmer. We're not swimmers. And she would acknowledge that. And she says the same thing about, hey, I would beat my husband in a race, but I'm not going to beat the best male there is. That's where this, you know, this diagram sort of gets drawn, and you talk about everything at the extreme ends of it. That's where we're having this conversation, because if we allow just the men who are best at their sports to infiltrate women's sports, then all of the spots are going to go to men.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, the argument is tougher to make than it should be, because nobody's suggesting that women aren't great at many sports. Women can be great at basketball and in baseball, et cetera. When I was young, we used to say if you sucked as a guy at throwing, we used to say you throw like a girl. Mm-hmm. Now girls don't throw like girls. Girls throw awesome. My daughter can throw a better fastball than I can these days. But like, it's just a fact that present day David Cone probably can throw a football better than almost all of the women on the earth.
Yeah.
And to the point about the line of, you know, coming out and hey, no one's here anymore because they don't watch women's sports. Obviously, if you go to a Nebraska volleyball game, like those things sell out all the time. Like that is a movement. There are situations like that. The entire world would want to watch Serena Williams in her prime play tennis. It's more just a generality, right? Like we're talking about generalities here where more people are going to watch the NFL, they're going to watch the NBA than they do the WNBA. And how should we react to that as a society? Is not to then take over those female spaces. Those are still important for the female athletes competing there.
Right. And those opportunities that oftentimes were afforded by Title IX are so important to women. As Tom mentioned, our daughter plays softball, and you know, seeing what that does for her, you realize how important it is. And knowing that she could grow up and have opportunities taken from her by a baseball player who played, you know, Cooperstown baseball and is now going to come in and take her spot on a college softball team because he decided to. It's like a crazy feeling to see that opportunity taken away.
Yeah. Well, I say this all the time, and it's so obvious. The best way to counter the argument outside of it just being common sense. I mean, it's not even political to me. I don't think it's political when I turn my blinker on in the interstate. I think it's political when I look both ways before I cross the street. It's a safety thing. I don't want to get hit by a car. It's just like we shouldn't have, you know, Shohei Ohtani hitting against some poor female. You don't have to be Sherlock Holmes to figure this out. But the best way to counteract it is, name me a woman, a biological woman, that is dominating a man's sport. I'll just wait. I'll hang up and listen. You can't, because it doesn't exist. It only exists one way, and it's the way that we're saying what is going to happen if we allow this to happen. So to me, I mean, I don't even know, like, the amount of mental gymnastics that it takes to convince yourself, outside of just lying, because we're as tribal as it's ever been when it comes to politics these days in this country, but the mental, you must be the Simone Biles of women, of mental gymnastics, to be able to arrive at a point that men and women should, let's let them play against each other. It makes all the sense in the world.
We are talking to Jay Crain and David Cohn of Crain and Company, a great podcast on the Daily Wire. Go follow them. You can follow them on Apple Podcasts, whatever. Go to the Daily Wire, get a premium membership, and watch Lady Ballers. It's absolutely fantastic. Some of these scenes that contain violence are some of the best scenes that I've seen really in 20 years. With humor, you're not supposed to do anymore. But, you know, I want to ask you guys something, both coming from backgrounds in and around sports. What happened to, like, good sportsmanship? Like, in other words, you know, shaking the person's hand at the end of a game, that thing that we used to do, even though it sucks and you hate the person, they might have just beat you. You know, part of being a good sport is sucking it up. But I'm worried about the guys. Like, what is it? Mm-hmm. When was it taught that you can, as a guy, feel good about competing against these girls who are smaller than you and taking a place? And like Leah Thomas always says, I'm really proud. I'm happy now. I'm proud. How are you happy?
Well, it's again, and it's such a common sense issue. I don't like the shame that I would have, even in the movie, dunking on stunt women, like people that do this professionally. I felt awful. My brother, who was in the wrestling scene, had to slam this poor girl, you know, she had padding on, stuff like that, multiple times. And he said he felt awful. I mean, he thought about the rest of the night, because that's ingrained in you biologically, because we know that men and women are so different. But the fact that you could walk around and pretend like it's okay, forget everybody else, forget your parents, forget the fans, forget the media, just yourself, how you as a biological man could lay your head down on the pillow at night, because you know deep down it's ridiculous. You know, it's shameful. I don't know. I think you just have to totally commit to being aloof, right? Or it's a trick. It's a trick to me. I couldn't do it. It's shameful to me.
Two things that I think this movie does really well are, one, the character of Alex, played by Daniel. I mean, he's clearly working through some sort of confusion, some sort of gender dysmorphia. And that's a great character arc to follow. I mean, we're acknowledging that there are people who are confused about who they are. I think there's a fantastic scene at the end between Alex and Coach Rob. And then the second thing is making the media the antagonist. That was so fun. Even the very first time that I read the script, to see it play out with what a great job Billy Ray did.
Unbelievable
with
job.
The character of Gwen.
But it was fantastic.
It's done for the clicks, right? For the headlines, for the stories, for these journalists to be able to make a name for themselves. We see it every night when you turn on the news. So the angle of making the media the primary antagonist in this film, I thought that it was brilliant, and I thought that it worked in the final version of the movie. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's interesting that you say that it was hard even to do it on a movie set, because part of me, especially the people who are like very well-known Daily Wire personalities like Jeremy Boring, I'm like, why is Jeremy Boring saying this stuff? Like, part of my brain was like, felt uncomfortable seeing, you know, people that I know and listen to all the time.
Well, then Matt Walsh must have thrown you for a loop then, because he was on the opposite end of the spectrum of where he is.
Don't worry, we got ours too at the end, because us getting dunked on at the end was the last thing. One of the last things that we shot, and that was painful.
Yes, it was.
Not only physically, but for the ego too.
Matt Walsh needs to, that needs to be a sequel. We need a sequel to come out of that. Who is the best actor, you think, in the whole company?
You know, I think, you know, everybody did a really good job. Not to cop out. I tell you what, I thought Tyler Fisher was hilarious. Now he's a professional comedian, but his, and again, I don't want to give away too many spoilers, his impression of a certain person that has been a big, big factor in culture and in beer. Maybe that'll give it away. But just being with him on set, being able to chop it up with him, I thought the character fit him perfectly. Absolutely 100% perfectly. And he killed it. And the little things, right? His movements, the stunts that he did. I thought Tyler was really good. I laugh every time I see, now I know Tyler, but every time I watch it and I know what's going to happen, I still laugh because Tyler absolutely geeks.
He's funny, man. The best actor in the movie, though, is clearly Jeremy Boring. And Jeremy, I would love to be cast in whatever the next project is. So you just remember who said that. But the best scene in the movie, though, is these guys doing the car dealership commercial.
Oh, that was fun.
There's a brotherly connection that just exists throughout this movie that only they can pull off. I think there was one table break scene scripted. And the first time Jeremy saw it, I think he wrote four more into the
script. Oh, yeah, we felt
it, too. But the car lot dealership commercial scene, I can just watch it on repeat. It's hilarious.
Well, the movie's fantastic. It's Crain and Company. Crain and Company is the show. The movie is Lady Ballers. You guys should watch it. Just subscribe to Daily Wire. Mm-hmm. It's the premium.
It's on the Daily Wire app. I believe that gets you all the Bentke Kids stuff too when you get that Daily Wire entertainment subscription, which is awesome. We have five kids, and so
it's a buffet of entertainment awesomeness. That's what it is.
It is, absolutely. And listen to Crain and Company. I just stumbled onto the show in the last few days. It's a great show. I'm back into sports.
Welcome home.
David Cone, by the way, David Cone, Michigan guy who actually wore number 12 at one point. You'd be very popular in New England these days.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. Yeah, like my Michigan brother, Tom Brady. Don't confuse me, though, with the David Cone that pitched for the Mets or the Yankees.
No.
I would never pitch for the Mets.
Yeah, we're from Braves country. Yeah. We ain't doing that up here. Y'all aren't either, apparently, from Boston. Y'all will hop right on that train with us.
Oh, you know what's funny enough, though? The only time I saw David Cone in person, he was with the Red Sox. He was doing a short stint. They came to Turner Field in Atlanta, and he was throwing in the bullpen. My dad took me up to see the Braves.
Well, it's funny. I heard something today, and I played baseball in college. I love baseball that I had never heard before. Do you know that the Red Sox traded Babe Ruth to be able to finance a play? Did you know that?
No.
Like a Broadway play.
Oh, that's why the curse exists.
Wild. I just found that out today.
That's correct. Yeah. Traded away from the Red Sox owner at the time wanted to bring in the play. It was a disgrace.
Better been a hell of a play.
It was not a good play. Guys, we really appreciate you. By the way, can you walk on, David, or what, to the Pats tryouts?
Look, man, I got some eligibility left. But we were throwing the football around here earlier.
Well, nowadays in college, you can play for 30 years. I mean, Bo Nix just got done with 14 years in college. So, I mean, I'm sure we can still go.
Look, last time Belichick got a Michigan quarterback, it worked out well. Let's give it a try. There's your pitch. I'll do it for
half. Your pitch. There it is.
Absolutely. Let's do it. All right. Crain and Company, Jake Crain and David Cone, guys, thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you, guys. Check out Lady Ballers on Daily Wire Plus. I think you'll enjoy it.
So once again, thank you to those guys, Jake Crain and David Cone. Those were great. We got to try to get Tyler Fisher on, too. I mean, I've loved that guy for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Go see the movie if you want to see the movie. We kind of made it a date night, Alice and I, but we're going to watch it again.
Yeah, we had fun. You can do it from the Daily Wire app and then Apple AirPlay or whatever it's called. You can put it right on your TV and the family watched it.
By the way... Yeah. I've worked with folks from Newsmax. In other capacities, we work with folks from Fox. We worked with the White House Communications Office to do a live press briefing when I was with the Boston Herald. And with all sorts of professional broadcasting outfits, there is nobody with their stuff together like the Daily Wire.
They were the best.
These people are, there is a team of people working with you. And they are so professional over there, so helpful and so awesome. When you get some of this, when you watch, what am I saying? Because I'm on video right now. How bizarre is this? You will have just enjoyed some of the wonderful video that they caught on their end. It's just a new one for me because they did it in their studio. They were they recorded angles, audio and visual from there.
Yes, and then afterwards they sent us multiple angles that we didn't get on the stream. And yeah, they're excellent people to work with. We love the Daily Wire, obviously.
Okay, it's time to get to some breaking news. Here, while we were talking, the Colorado Supreme Court threw Trump off the ballot.
Including the primary ballot in Colorado, is my understanding. So this will be appealed to the Supreme Court, presumably, by the Trump lawyers. And but the, I mean, there's limited time because I think what I was reading says they have until I think January 5th to for the GOP to submit their official people to be on the primary ballot.
Because he is disqualified, it would be a wrongful act under the election code for the Colorado Secretary of State to list him as a candidate in the presidential primary ballot. The court says its ruling the court stays its ruling until January 4th, like you said.
Right. So January 5th, yeah. That's when they're going to put the GOP can't. That's when they have to certify who's on the ballot for the GOP primary in Colorado. There are other states that want to do this also. My gut feeling is that this type of overreaction is exactly the kind of thing that's going to piss enough people off to push Trump over the edge back into the White House.
Yes,
I mean, Trump is like the ideal candidate for a write-in campaign. You could not have a better write-in candidate. His name is short, easy to spell, and known by every single person in America, pretty much.
So what does this mean? Is this happens for other states? Like I was saying, I think this means, I think this is power. If you're trying to pile on Trump in every single way and destroy him, people who had never had a dog in this fight are going to hear about this underdog who's being attacked and maligned by all these people, and people are going to say, "Forget that." They will not have it.
I don't know what.
So I'm going to get to Michelle Wu is just caught up in another lie. She has gone and to try to keep the narrative going that she planted in NPR yesterday, saying the new documentary with the Globe and in HBO on Willie Bennett, the guy who was accused of shooting Charles Stewart, mm-hmm. who actually shot his wife and himself. She's saying there's still fresh tensions because the documentary just came out. The Willie Bennett thing happened 35 years ago. We've already been through it. We already did all the apologizing. It's over. It's gone. It's in the past. For her to try to plant this as a news story, as a diversion to her racist party is ridiculous. She officially apologized. Ray Flynn, I looked it up, back then apologized in 90 or 91 or whatever mm-hmm. to the family. And it was public. So it's already happened.
Did anyone even know there was a documentary out right now? Was this like some huge news story that I missed? Like, was everybody talking about this case again?
Globe people would know because they love it. And they need a new fresh case. But I didn't know until Michelle Wu threw it out there as a diversionary tactic. But we can talk about that on the Patreon. We should get to the chat.
Okay, yes. A lot of chat messages.
Yes. What is the chat?
That is the Chelsea Fire Wicked Hotline chat brought to us by Chelsea Fire Wicked Hot Sauce.
All right. Are you ready, Allison?
I'm ready.
Well, after a very hectic 24 hours running the KMS Twitter account, it's time to get back to normalcy. And I wanted to know, Alice, what your nationality, I think you said you're Serbian,
mm-hmm.
does on Christmas Eve. I wonder if you have any special traditions. Italians, we have the seven fishes on Christmas Eve, and I was wondering if you guys did something similar. Thanks.
So this is actually really interesting to me because the Feast of the Seven Fishes is actually a remnant of when Catholics used to fast before Christmas also, not just in Lent for Easter, but during there used to be an Advent fast in the Catholic Church. The Orthodox still fast in the lead up to Christmas as well. Actually, the Orthodox have four fasts a year plus Wednesdays and Fridays. So so the Feast of the Seven Fishes would be on Christmas Eve because you wouldn't be eating meat on Christmas Eve still because you wouldn't break your fast until Christmas Day. You know, you wouldn't be eating meat until Christmas morning. So the Orthodox generally, they do a fish-based dinner on Christmas Eve.
But Alice Shattuck does not, generally.
Well, I haven't fasted this year because I've been
pregnant. Right, but you have done the fast in the past. But generally around Christmas, we do a Yankee Christmas, I guess.
Well, yeah. So we do regular American Christmas with the kids with the stockings and stuff. Serbian Christmas, Serbs like the Russians, they follow the Julian calendar rather than the Gregorian calendar, which means that on that calendar, December 25th falls on what most people consider to be January 7th. So our Christmas Eve would be, it's called Badnja Veče, and there's sort of, I guess, what you would roughly translate to be like a Yule log, where you do, where you bless oak branches, the badniak, and you would light that at your home and your fire at home.
Very nice.
So, and sing songs about the badniak. And
very nice.
So, yeah, that's a Serbian Christmas Eve, but celebrated on, by our modern calendar, on January 6th on the evening of. It's quite a long church service, by the way. Shocker. I know.
Steve from Aramex.
Hey, Steve.
I concur with Dr. Cheswick's assessment of the treatment of the guest the other night, the kid from the main wire.
Edward, that was Edward Tomich, and...
I'm sorry, I it comes Steve, very naturally to me to talk over it.
Yeah, well, I think Steve's going to slam you because I did not say anything over him.
First of all, Tom, you said, I've known him for 10 years. Jesus, God, how old was he when you met him? 10?
Yes.
He looked like...
Yes, actually.
That is a good point.
No, you, 12, you, but yes. Yes,
he was close. It really sounds kind of shady, doesn't it?
He was about 22 years old.
Yes.
Second... He did not look comfortable the entire time. Yeah. Like, he was sitting on the couch next to Alice, the Earth Mother, breastfeeding both sides.
Oh, yeah.
And he just looked uncomfortable, and he had to hold the mic the entire time.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, Jesus, treat your guests better.
It was under Alice's instruction that he be placed where he was, that she get to use the thing, that he had to hold the mic. We could have had him just have a normal mic. But, yeah, there seemed to be specifically targeted cruelty towards Mr. Tomich, who's a great guy, by the way.
Maybe next time Edward from the main wire is on, you could actually shock him with a live wire. Oh, boy. Oh. Ouch. That was a tough one.
What? Taking a shot at Edward? How dare you, good sir? How dare you? I think he was great. I thought he was great. Mm-hmm. In the parts where Alice wasn't stepping on him, he's very insightful. He's got stuff to say. It's his first time in here. It's very intimidating being in here.
Is it?
In the studio. Not from you. For you. This is your coven. But it's very...
I'm not intimidated by
you. For people who aren't... Anytime we've had other people in there, they've been rather nervous. And it's a, you know, it's just a very... This is like being on Rogan, you know?
Yeah, so true.
And also, I think, and Edward mentioned this, that he didn't want to talk over me. Like, there are times that he didn't, you know, we don't do it a lot together in person. So he was, like, demurring. What is one of those words?
Deferring, I would go with.
No, it's not it, though. He wasn't deferring to me. Not really.
Okay.
But, yeah, he was fantastic. Dear Tim. Tim, by the way, COVID. SARS-CoV-19.
Sorry, Tim.
That's right. He didn't social distance. He didn't wear his mask.
I feel like we have COVID now from
him. In his defense, I mean, it's very difficult to get a word in on the step-ons. And, I mean, you did make him do the dishes, mind the kids, then sit down in the kiddie chair and hold his own microphone for like an hour and a half. So
true.
Can't really blame him. I'm going to lay the blame somewhere else. I'll let you two figure out where, but
yes,
it's not on Edward.
Yes. I think as people scratch the surface more, it'll become apparent who the problem lay with, Alice. Lay with. BBP.
Burn Barrel Podcast.
Oh, hold on. Adams and the Immigration.
So, Mayor Adams... thinks New York is a brand. Yeah, it is a brand. The brand's bullshit. Dog shit.
You know,
awful.
I was hoping to cut some stuff.
But he's passing the buck. He don't think he can get the legals out of his city, but well, that's what he tells his constituents and stuff, but it's the polar opposite. You can get these immigrants, these illegals, out of your city, but you choose not to. Like, you can look at, like, Abbott, for example. They don't want them there. I don't think most people want illegals to be overflowing in their cities or towns. Do it the right way. Come on.
it's wild how many people.
Fetterman's making sense.
Yeah, he's right.
It's wild how many people there are. Bill Malugin keeps posting videos from the border and saying how many crossings they're having each day. And it's like in the tens of thousands a day now.
Yeah, last night it looked like a sea of people. And Michael Yon is down in Panama and he's like, oh yeah, there's many more coming up. It's like, okay.
And there are people from all over. This isn't like they're coming from all over because they know that the border's open.
Which is another thing to impeach Biden for.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's one of the more valid
things. Refusing to run the country. That's absolutely in the president's wheelhouse, is they are supposed to be doing immigration policy.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It's a total forfeiture of his job. It's a dereliction of duty, like we said Trump did when he called the dogs off at the Capitol. This is much worse, obviously. This is an actual invasion of people we don't know.
Good Lord, with this sad sack Santa story from last night. Nobody wants to talk to me. I don't like to talk to anybody. You're only in the jolliest suit ever created.
Yes.
Doesn't matter what religion, political belief you might have or culture you come from. Everybody loves Santa. It's not even religious.
Well, now, Tim.
Nobody wants to talk to me.
When I was as Santa, first I came in as Tom Shattuck, and nobody knew me, really. Nobody knew me at all, actually. Not even really. Nobody knew me. And then I was Santa. When I was Santa, people were saying, Santa! And then I switched back into clothes again, plain clothes. And yes, I was in the corner. I did have a good conversation with one guy about radio. But, oh yeah, I didn't do my set. I did a set, you know, as Santa. Should I do one of my jokes?
Yeah, do one of your jokes.
I'm going to do two of my jokes.
I hope you showed them your Trump impression.
I did not. I thought about that, though. Uncomfortable Santa! They call him. Okay. So my Trump impression sounds more like Harvey Fierstein, as a matter of fact.
So, what's up with that?
So here's my... Want to hear my bit?
Yes. Let's hear it.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Merry Christmas. Oh, long way from the North Pole. So here's a special tip for you. If you get an invite to deliver gifts to a Senate hearing room unannounced, don't. I'll just say, brings a whole new meaning to the term filibuster. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
You can laugh, Alice. You know what's hilarious? I made up every part of that joke except for... No, wait. I didn't make up either part of the joke. The first part of it, Michael Graham made up. The last part of it, Adam Ligio, my mole in the Connecticut Senate, made up. Which is... A mole goes unnamed, so he doesn't get in trouble. My second one is, yeah, but Republicans and Democrats are very different. Did you realize they are different, Alice?
They might be different. How could they be different?
Well, it's interesting. This time of year, every year, Republicans sing Over the River and Through the Woods, and Democrats sing From the River to the Sea. Huh? That's part of my set that I did. I did about 10 minutes.
I'm rolling.
Well, let me tell you something. That From the River to the Sea got gasps. Like, that was, like, really in bad taste. And I thought, wait, you know, there could be a lot of Democrats here, too. Maybe there was. The biggest hit of the night was
I mean, I don't get why, though, because they do chant that, actually.
The biggest hit of the night was a sight gag that had to do with John Sununu, what he asked for Christmas, and it was a sight gag. It was a contract from CNN. It's an inside New Hampshire joke that he wants to do that. And the second biggest hit of the night, of course, was the filibuster joke.
Of course.
And then I did a bonus joke.
Okay.
The R-rated, the one that made you uncomfortable yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
You want to hear my bonus joke?
Let's hear the bonus joke.
That I ended with, because Graham asked me, he said, do you want to say another joke? Do you have anything else? And I said, oh, you know what? Let's try this again. Here's a tip for you. If you're ever invited to deliver a bunch of presents to a Senate hearing room down in Washington, D.C., unannounced, don't do it. Some pretty freaky stuff happened down there. And it's interesting when Republicans do it, they call it an insurrection. I'm sorry, no. Yes. When Republicans do it, they call it an insurrection. But when Democrats do it, I'm pretty sure that guy was in Sir's rectum. Hmm?
Okay.
That one, the audience was not comfortable with, generally. Some of the people, like, okay. They were like, and that was it. And then I was played out.
I find it hard to talk to people like the nice teeth. Listen, we all know what you're up to there, Shattuck. It's so apparent. You go on and on about how comfortable the suit is, the jacket, the hat.
Yes.
How much you want to just wear it around. And then you want to just turn that frown upside down to a big old Cheshire Cat smile, leering when you get home to see your lovely wife and guilt her into putting on the damn Mrs. Claus suit.
Hear, hear.
We all know what you're doing.
Hear, hear.
By the way, I hope it worked, buddy. I hope it worked.
Thank you. Thank you. Alice is not Mrs. Claus suit ready now. She's not. She's her hot body has not returned to its former status. I'm not saying anything that you're not saying.
Mm-hmm, that's true.
Don't make it sound like I'm saying something mean.
I'm not.
My
not
body has returned
anything.
To Santa status. Alice's body has not returned.
You are
to,
Santa ready. That is true.
Alice's body is not returned to its sexy lingerie status. This is all her words. It's not my words. I spent a lot of time last year trying to get her. Spent a lot of time. That's close.
That was closer than usual. It was not. You need to be wispier.
Spend a lot of time. Ooh.
That's better.
I am getting there. You bastards. All of you who even called me on my phone to tell me to never
I
do
like
that
you
again.
Workshopping this in front of everybody. Can you do it in your mirror to yourself?
Hi, Steve from Merriman.
Hi, Steve.
Tom, I know you struggle with your sexuality sometimes. You've admitted to it through the years, but I think it's time to come fully out because only a raving queen like yourself would want to drink something called banana-flavored Happy Dads. Jesus Christ. Yes, shopkeeper, I would like some banana-flavored Happy Dads. Yes, sir, of course. And what attracts you to the banana? Is it the shape? Oh! Oh, you're such a freaking...
It is a rather, now that I think about it, this is a very gay drink. There's no, it's hard, Happy Dad, seltzer. I never thought, actually, is this the official drink of the gay community? This is banana flavored. It's gluten-free, too, okay? Yeah, it is definitely a gay drink. Okay. Albie Shattuck, guess what? Can you feel it? Can you feel it coming?
Mm-hmm. Are we going to the Patreon show?
Can you feel it coming in the air tonight?
Thank you so much for putting up with us.
You know who sings that song?
No.
I can feel it coming in the air tonight. You don't know who sings that?
Mm-mm.
Doesn't matter.
So thank you for putting up with everything in the live stream. The uploaded version will be better. So if you're listening to the uploaded version, you don't know what I'm talking about, hopefully. Anyway, but to the people on the live stream, you can stay there. We're going to hop over and do the Patreon show. Hopefully that works for us. We do have some more things we want to comment on. You can join us for that patreon.com/burnbarrel or for free at burnbarrelpodcast.com.